Amen. O Lord, may the meditations of my mouth and my heart be acceptable unto you, O God. A long time ago, the living God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, called forth the descendants of Jacob, remember his 12 sons, which had grown to a sizable number out of the existence of slavery in Egypt about 1300 B.C. is the context of the Old Testament. And by the power of God to go through the desert, and they went into the promised land. This was a promise. Some may doubt it, but if you want proof of the existence of the Jewish people, you can look around the world that they eventually were spread, called the diaspora of Jewish people around the world. And then, more proof, you can look to Israel, online there in the city of Jerusalem, and the western wall is the temple that goes back to the time of Jesus. All of this speaks of the history of Israel out of Egypt and then came over there to eventually Jerusalem and built the city. That's the background. And of Exodus 16. And now, in honor to make a connection, in honor of Black History Month, and remembering the Exodus, that God heard the cries and groanings of the people of his, that were his covenant people that he made with Abraham. And then he cares about the suffering of people everywhere caught in various forms of bondage. We remember today at the African American Reading many of these historical events. For African Americans or blacks were caught or forced into the system of slavery here in the U.S. and then over time through the Civil War and the Emancipation Proclamation declared by Abraham Lincoln in the 1960s that blacks should be free. They were, but still the journey towards equality and full participation in the U.S. society has been a long struggle. Most noticeably, Martin Luther King Jr., I believe a modern-day prophet, he spoke the truth of God to our situation here in the U.S. and gave himself to a nonviolent campaign against the situation here in the U.S. that we would actually live up to and practice our beliefs. He lost his life to a white gunman, and then in his attempt to liberate us, this country, from the prejudices and inequalities built into the structures of our country, as well as the entangled fallen beliefs of the human heart, the U.S. has been growing and making progress. Particularly within the body of Christ, we are called to express this love for one another. And Jesus said in Mark 7, from within the heart comes the real evil. On the list of things that were there, including murder, covetousness, and the whole list of things. He says that's the real problem. Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And all throughout the Bible, there, the human heart, the Old Testament, New Testament, Solomon said in Proverbs, above all, guard the heart, the wellspring of life. At the root of fallen humankind is a heart problem. And from it spring many, many things. So now, return to that Old Testament passage in Exodus 16. The people of Israel have come out of slavery and bondage by a powerful action of God. You remember the story? There were plagues, and the last plague was the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, and the angel of death went over, but the people of Israel were protected by that blood, and they gradually came out with a mighty outstretched arm. Out of Egypt and then into the desert, now they have a problem. First it was water, and then it was food. They became sat by the meat pots, and when we had our fill of bread, the Israelites came to realize that while God had brought them out of slavery in Egypt, and into the wilderness, now their life is less than appealing. It was difficult. But the Lord heard their murmurings and their groanings and gave them bread. My lesson from this is the one whom he redeems, he cares for. The people of Israel, he redeemed them. He's just not going to leave them to die in the desert. He cares for them. And God said, I'll bring bread from heaven for you. And for us, he's redeemed us through his Son. And he cares for us also. So, they are given manna in the morning and quails in the evening. And in verse 4 it says, the people should go out and gather a daily portion that I might test them. Well, that's the challenge. Enough bread each day that they can collect and the amount needed, but not enough for the next day. So every day you have to trust God for his provision. The people he redeems, he cares for and provides bread. And all of you, by faith in Jesus Christ, have come out of slavery of sin, and now he cares for you. We are people then, by analogy, we were there in Egypt. He brought us forth from the plagues. He brought us out of Egypt, through the Red Sea, into the desert. We are also Israelites. We are like them. He cares for us. This past Friday night, the men's group went down to the car show here in downtown Pittsburgh. And there's a fun outing, a chance to look around, hang out, have fun, and look at these incredible cars. Wow! What a marvel of technological advancement by the human brain. Many people put that together over here, these cars. They're beautiful. We could be tempted like the Israelites. Do you think so? Oh, Lord, I'll never get a car like that one. One of those $60,000 or $50,000 or $44,000 cars. Wow, those stickers. That's what you call sticker shock, right? Well, we would say, Lord, I am bored here in the desert. Oh, look at those Canaanites over there. They've got some nice cars. But Lord, help me. And God can come back and say, I am taking care of your needs. I have redeemed you. Plus, I've given you a camel with a 3-speed shifter to make it all the way to the promised land. Bible scholars, that was a joke, nobody laughed. Bible scholars remind us that we are created with a need for daily food as a reminder that God is providing for our needs over and over and over again each day. In our culture, do families sit down and eat together? We've taken our food for granted. We live in a highly developed world of complex systems of farming, automated farming, manufacturing, and trucking. Try to figure out where your loaf of bread comes from someday. It's very complex. Fragile systems that can be upset by global warming or terrorists. But what did you know, in many parts of the world, people still work in the fields or in the factories and live for food each day. Just enough rice or just enough bread. The whole purpose of this chapter, verse 11, I've heard the complaints and murmurings of my people. In the evening they get quail, and in the morning you are filled with bread so that you will know that I am the Lord your God. He redeems us. He feeds us. Do we know him? And in the New Testament passage by analogy, Jesus redeems us and he feeds us. There's a vast number of people in the New Testament passage that are there hearing Jesus teach and they are hungry. And Jesus meets get to look. He reveals who he is. He says, I'm one from the Father. I've come from the Father. He says, he's the bread of life. You eat this bread, you'll be hungry again. But if you eat the bread I give you, you'll never be hungry. You know, I found out living in Southeast Asia that really it's not the idea, I am the bread of life. And people say, what's that, bread? A lot of people don't know bread. You have to change it over and say, I'm the rice of life. In a lot of parts of the world, they don't even know what bread is. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert and they died, but here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man can eat and not die. The very essence of life is that God is giving of himself in Jesus Christ. That's the miracle of the whole thing. Amazing. But then there's more to the story. The people continue to seek him, not for who he is, but for the signs or for more bread or more miracles. I tell you the truth, you're looking for me not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. And Jesus really calls them. There's more than just a good free meal here. I want you to see beyond that to me what I'm giving you. So it's a miracle, this changing of the multiplying of the bread and the loaves. A miracle can change a person. And they can open us up, change our motivation, change our perspective on many things. Certainly, everyone who believes in Christ, that's a miracle in and of itself, because something has been working in your heart. Remember the story of Peter, the miraculous catch of fish? Jesus is on the shore, and he says, little children, have you caught any fish? They said, no. He says, cast your net over here. And Peter, you know, he's been working all night. He says, there's no fish in here. But he says, if you say so. And when he did that, that fish came in, and he has to get his buddies together, and they pull it, pull the nets, and they go on shore. And when Peter gets there before Jesus, what's he do? He kneels down and says, go away from me, Jesus. I am a sinful man. Peter was shaken up. He was changed from within. A miracle can do that. Peter was changed and through and through in a good way as becoming a follower of Christ. This was really incredible. So it was life-altering event for the people that are involved. Miracles can do that. They can change us and how we might see God. Or what might be one perspective then can be changed. What Jesus is looking in here is that you're seeking me because of certain gifts and fringe benefits. He wants us to seek the gift, the giver, that is him, over the gift. He was not just looking for them to come for a free meal, but finding and going beyond it. This I see in the text, and this happened here. They would say, great, it's wonderful, 5,000 people are there. And will they go beyond the meal that has gathered them? James Montgomery Boyce, the great preacher, said that we have made his commentary in the Gospel of John. He says, we have now come to the place in U.S. Christianity that is lamentable. This tendency of seeking the Lord for personal need and not just seeking God himself. And I think maybe there's a fine line there. Our need drives us to God. Our pain, our brokenness, our illnesses. And then when we find him, we no longer need him. So we relax until there's another problem and then we seek him. I think all seeking know is one that God honors. So why, in a sense, why do we come? Why do we come to church? Why do you go? It's good to ask that question. we've made an effort to come and to seek Him and to worship Him. I know when I was younger, and they asked that kind of question to the youth group, and one guy was honest and said, the reason I come to church is because of the girls, the cute girls. And they said, and the pastor said, well, did you find any? And he said, well, they don't pay any attention to me. But he kept coming. So you seek me, maybe you're seeking me because of a side thing, and maybe you'll find something more. Do not work for the food that spoils, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which is the Son of God, and He will give Himself to you. Because God the Father set His seal on Him. No, aim below, I think. We dissatisfy. Aim up high. Aim for the, in a sense, the highest heaven. And you get even more. The Apostle Paul said, set your mind, your affections on the things above, not on the things of earth, where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. C.S. Lewis said, aim at heaven and you get earth thrown in. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. What Jesus is doing here is like the woman, the encounter of the woman at the well. You know, you drink this water from this well, you'll be thirsty tomorrow. And I'll give you something more than you'll ever be thirsty. Eat this bread, you'll be hungry tomorrow. But I'll give you a bread that you'll never be hungry with. Who is that? What is that? It is Himself. It is Jesus in and of Himself. So how do we get our needs met? That's what I'm asking in this text. I'm thinking it to myself. And from the whole of the New Testament, the answer would be, as I seek Him, so I get my needs met. So I seek Him for the sake of seeking the Lord, period. And He meets my needs, and He gives even more. That's the secret. Seeking Him as the end in itself. Not just seeking Him for what He can give as a means to the end, but finding Jesus for the person and what He has in and of Himself. What must we do to do the works of God requires there in this text is that it's pointing to works righteousness or working things my way, a zeal for God, not according to knowledge, but we're working our way into His presence. That's the old works righteousness for you theologians. But looking instead for this verse, do not labor for the food that perishes, which the Son of Man can give. It's Him, the free gift of life, of grace. What must we do then? This work, what is the work that we do? To believe in the One who is sent. Do something. Believe in something or someone. Where you say, Pastor, I'm doing my best. I do this, I do that, hoping that I might get to heaven by my good works. How good do you have to be on the scale of 1 to 100? Well, we know that it is by His grace. It is the gift of Jesus Christ as the bread that we can take and into our lives. As we surrender to Him and give our lives to Him, we are filled with His very life. So it's more than just a free lunch, a free meal. You gave us this one meal in Christ. Moses gave it every day for 40 years in the desert, this manna. And most assuredly, Moses didn't give the bread, but God did. See, we recognize beyond Moses working with the people a real gift of God's hand. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger again. And true spirituality must be a nutrition that comes from Him as a free gift. It's not a loaf of bread. It is His very life. So John loves to move from the physical plane. plane to the spiritual plane. He's got all those sayings there in the gospel. I'm the bread of life. I'm the light of the world. I'm the door. I'm the good shepherd. I'm the true vine. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And finally, I'm the resurrection and the life. I am. Now Jesus is moving on a level where is he divine? Who would ever say those kind of things? All that the Father gives me, whoever comes to me, whoever comes to me, I'll never cast out in them. It's chapter 6. So God has chosen you by divine election, and you must choose him. There's two parts to it. He's choosing you this day, but yet you must cooperate and choose him. Decide to sit down and eat at this table and take his bread and drink of the wine that he gives. And he says, I'm the bread that has come down from heaven. And in that chapter 6, they grumbled at him. Is this not Joseph's son? We know him. We know his parents. How can he say, I've come down from heaven and I'm the bread that come down from heaven? They're so confused. They said, who is this guy? He's crazy. No one can come to the Father unless he draws them. He's drawing you today through his Holy Spirit. He is displaying a behavior which is evidence that this guy, Jesus, is both human and divine. I've come down from heaven. That's absolutely unacceptable. And eat this bread and you get life from me? It's crazy. He goes back even to the book of Isaiah, which was prophesied, his kingdom will be everlasting and there will be no end to it. So the challenge, and in closing today, is the question for us, even though we are Christians and we have been redeemed, we've been to the foot of the cross, we've been, the chains of slavery, of sin have been broken, we are out of the desert. He gives us a 3-speed camel. He gives us bread and quail and water. But then sometimes we go back to feasting on junk food and fast food. The question is, what bread is really the bread that we're satisfied with? What is the bread that we're seeking still as Christians? We know that Jesus Christ really satisfies, but we end up going to other tasty tables, other tasty buffets, seeking for something else. But yet the difficulty is the wonder of finding Christ and continuing seeking him. This is why we need a friend, we need a partner. Whenever I used to visit and take treks into the far country of northern Thailand and take a long time of eating rice and veggies, I never tired from returning home, and it seemed like a default setting, you know, on your computer is to go back to the thing that you were raised on, you know, which is a piece of bread with a slice of cheese and put some peanut butter on there, and I was like, could never let that go. And so we have to come back again. We've been redeemed and set free from slavery. And we know Christ, but still we may seek other buffet tables for real satisfaction. This text is saying all other buffet tables lead to death. They will not satisfy. And even though we are Christian and have Christ within our hearts, people can seek that. Refocus our lives in this material culture and know that the bread that really satisfies is the very life of Christ, which he gives as a free gift. We have to sit down and eat and take him into our lives. It is through that that our hearts are changed and we become the kind of people that can also today. As we close and sing our final hymn, number 152, I want to